Welcome to Life and Liberty Radio with David Householder. I'm Josh Jose, and together, you and I are taking another step toward freedom, both spiritual and political. So get comfortable, breathe in, and ignite your imagination. Envision a society that is spiritually deep and truly free. It's easy if you try.
I'm very interested in education, and knowing what you know now, and what you're continuing to learn, what would you change about the way doctors are trained? If you were in charge of educational process for doctors in the United States, if you were the chief medical education person, what specific things would you do to make it more effective?
Well, I would eliminate the four-year college prerequisite. I think it should be amalgamated all into one curriculum. If you're going to be a doctor, you should go in and
Just be a doctor.
You don't need to take medieval history. Why did I have to take medieval history? You know, I could care less about medieval history, but I had to take it. And it was, you know, 3 months of misery, a lot of memorization, a lot of work, and it did absolutely nothing other than waste my time. And so we should be, you know, there's so much to know about medicine now. Get started as soon as you can. I would, you know, even in high school, you should be saying, okay, this I'm going to be a doctor, and this is what I want to be, and that's what I want to be. And, you know, just start training and learn the things and learn them well. That's what we're training people with. Yeah, okay, yeah, it's liberal arts education is all very good and all that kind of thing. If you want to start practicing medicine at 40, you know, but
it's taking a long time.
I was not able to practice until I was 35. You know, come on, I spent a lot of time in education, and that's with us. That was with a pre-med education. I went through college in 3 years, and then I went on. I got 2 years in my master's degree in biochemistry, 4 years in pathology. You know, you got 4 years in medical school, a year of internship. It starts to add up, you know. And if I had those 3 years of college where I was taking history and weird courses, I took, you know, fly fishing. Hey, great. How many times have I gone fly fishing? You know, yeah, it was nice to learn how to go fly fishing, but, I mean, there was courses that you had to take, physical therapy or whatever they had, that made no sense. I mean, what do I care about? I haven't had time to go fly fishing ever, even though I know how to do it, and nor am I that much interested. I'm much more interested in medicine. Mm-hmm. So when I have time off, I either go to medical meetings or I'm in my library studying, because I love medicine. I love to figure out what's going on with people and myself and try to help do what I can to help people. I think it's a great
calling.
Getting
to the age, too, where you've had enough experience where you can actually do something with the new stuff you're learning, because it takes a long time.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, it takes a lot of time and effort to become a really good doctor, and you need people to get at it as soon as possible. So that's what I always say. We should have a more, you know, take a 6 year. Instead of 4 years of medical school, it should be at least six, maybe even seven, just like the same amount of time, 3 years of college and 4 years of medical school. Well, take that 3 years of college and forget that and just put it all into one curriculum, and so that whoever the big dean of that medical school can plot out how exactly they want their medical students to be taught. I mean, we all have to be able to read and write and whatnot and write our reports and whatnot. So that could be there. But you could be started. Instead of having essays on Shakespeare, you could be writing essays on gallbladders. Which is, in other words, make a more focused education than what we have.
Plus, people get out of it. If they realize it's not for them, they can get out of it sooner.
Right.
Which would be nice, because you go to 4 years of school, you work hard to get into medical school,
right,
and a couple years into it,
there's no
terrible.
Question. There's no question. I had an acquaintance. She was in pathology training. Here she was. She had gone through medical school, internship, psychiatry training. She became a psychiatrist and decided she didn't like that, and she went back into pathology because she didn't like. She was really neurotic herself, and so instead of going to medical school and becoming a psychiatrist and a pathologist, she needed to stop what she was doing and go have psychotherapy herself.
Yeah.
Really, and that was, you know, there was a whole life wasted as far as I was concerned, because she really had never identified exactly what she needed to do And she just started off thinking that mother told her to do it and whatever, and that maybe she could solve her own problems by studying psychiatry. I think a lot of psychiatrists are in that boat because they go into it because they don't understand themselves, so they think maybe if they're studying it, they'll learn how to figure out how to take care of themselves and get themselves healthy. You know, but in reality, they needed to stop and day one, have some really good counseling and be exposed to it.
You find it out so much sooner if you started sooner.
Right. If you're going to go to medical school and want to be a doctor, you should go work with a doctor once in a while, and a few different types of doctors, and spend a day here and a day there to get some kind of background. You know, like the first time we had surgery class in surgery, they showed on a slide on a movie screen somebody doing some operations, and they had a picture of a big needle and a syringe going into somebody's arm, and the needle is wobbling, and the blood drips out of this, and the guy is and this is happening, about half of the class literally falls over and collapses onto the floor. Swear to God, it's like the whole class, almost seems like the whole class fell over onto the floor, passed out.
And they should know that about themselves.
Yes. You don't want to say, I'm going to be a surgeon and get sick at the sight of blood.
Well, exactly. It's like someone trained to be an astronaut and not realizing they get car sick real fast.
Really?
You know, so it's one of those things.
Yeah, and people say, well, you can be anything you want to be. That's not true at all. You cannot be anything you want to be if you just put your mind to it and work hard. That's just not true. There's a lot of crap out there, which I'm sorry to tell you that, you know, it's just the way it is. You can't take your body and change it that much to become an astronaut when you're a 95-pound weakling with bad eyesight and bad hearing and you get car sick. You know, you just are not going to be a great astronaut, or, you know, you might be a better jockey.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah.
So you have to take your body and identify everything you can about it, learn everything you can about it.
Well, genetics, you can learn a lot about that.
You can learn the genetics. You know, the more you can study your own body and figure out what's good for your own body and follow that, the better off you're going to be in life. That's all there is to it.
Well, I joined the cross-country team, and I should have been a sprinter because I looked at my genetic stuff, and I had double fast twitch fibers, which now explains why I could dunk a basketball and could do high jump without practicing. And I didn't even think about it at the time, but if you'd known that, you could find, not just physically, but intellectually and otherwise, what things you're suited for. My genetics, we'll close with this, my genetics exam said that I have a tendency, that people with my genetic type have a tendency towards retardation with mathematics, and I always wondered why I had so much trouble with that. Now, if I would have known that earlier, I would have just taken the basic math class and through sixth grade just left it at that. Because it was useless to do all the other things.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, how many of us have beat ourselves up trying to learn something, and just no matter what we do, we just can't learn?
Yeah, we're picking up Greek and Hebrew is not a problem for me. Dead languages? Yeah, I can do that. So
that's great.
People are different.
You know, I can hardly speak English.
Well, Dr. David Steinblock, thanks so much for this conversation. How do people access your work? You've got some videos out there.
You can go to YouTube. I've got a number of videos on YouTube about stem cells and cerebral palsy and ALS and all kinds of different diseases. So my website is www.stemcellmd.org, STEMCELLMD.ORG. stemcellmd.org, and I've got lots and lots and lots of information about all kinds of different things there, so take a look there, and you can always just write me and write a note. There's a place there to write in and ask questions and call the office if you want to, if you have a major kind of medical problem that you need help with that nobody else has been able to solve, call our 800 number, 800-300-1063.
Well, thanks so much for this conversation. I got through one-third of my questions, so I hope to come back sometime and we'll cover some of the other stuff. But I find this absolutely fascinating that we've got so much changing. Thanks so much for this conversation. We'll talk to you again real soon.
Oh, thank you.
Well, that's all for today on Life and Liberty Radio. Thanks so much for sharing this part of your spiritual journey with me. Now, the views on this program are not necessarily those of my advertisers, sponsors, places I work or do business with. They're purely my own, but I'm sharing them with you, so share your ideas with me. Write me on Twitter at Liberty House, LibertyHouse, no E. Until next time, let's continue dreaming and working for a free and spiritually grounded society.